I'll present the paper Communication Complexity of the Circuit Key Agreement in Algorithmic Information Theory. My name is Emirhan Gürpınar and my co-author is my PhD advisor, Andrei Romaschenko. I'll start with an informal introduction. So this is the standard problem of Circuit Key Agreement for two parties. A well-known and practical version of this problem is the Feynman problem, where Alice and Bob don't share any initial information in the beginning at first, and then they communicate via a public channel which can be listened to, which can be eavesdropped by the adversary, who is supposed to have some limited computational power. And at the end of the communication, both Alice and Bob are able to compute the secret key, but eavesdropper, adversary, cannot compute it. So this is some problem for which there are practical solutions called Diffie-Hellman protocols, but we are more interested in information theoretical aspects of this kind of setting of secret key agreement. That's why we don't suppose any restrictions on the computational power of the adversary. And as a consequence, we need to give Alice and Bob some initial keys which are correlated, X for Alice and Y for Bob. And here the challenge is to use the correlation between X and Y so that Alice and Bob can establish a key which cannot be known by the eavesdropper who has access to this communication transcript. Now one can ask, what is the optimal size of the secret key? How large can the secret key be when Alice and Bob are establishing a key in this protocol? The answer is given in the theorem by Romaschenko and Zeman in their 2019 paper, that the optimal size of the secret key is mutual information of X and Y in Kolmogorov complexity. I will explain what this is in the next slide, up to some logarithmic additive term, logarithmic in size of X and size of Y, so length of X and length of Y. And the question that was open in their paper is the communication complexity of this problem, where Alice and Bob have not only X and Y in the beginning, but also have their own different random strings. So some random bits of Alice, private to Alice, Bob doesn't know, and randomness of Bob that Alice doesn't know. So in this setting, communication complexity of course cannot be worse than the communication complexity without randomness, because randomness cannot hurt, it cannot deteriorate or decrease communication complexity. And in the proof of this theorem, Romaschenko and Zeman have given a general protocol for general X and Y, which uses C of X given Y bits of communication. This means that this is an upper bound for the open problem. And this also is an upper bound for the answer of the open problem. So the minimum of these two is an upper bound. And I use this approximation symbol here because this is up to some logarithmic additive term. So I can delete this and write here plus C log n with C some constant. All right, now I'll give the basic definition of Kolmogorov complexity. So let X, Y, and W be the strings in 0, 1. That is, they are bit strings. They are words on alphabet of two letters 0 and 1. They are finite words here, say of size n or something. They can be of any size, any finite size. Then complexity of X is length of the shortest program producing X. That is, in an optimal programming language, the shortest program that prints X as output has the size C of X. Or in an optimal description mode, the shortest description of X is of the size C of X. In similar way, we define C of X given Y, conditional Kolmogorov complexity conditioned on Y of X. And it is the length of the shortest program that prints X as output when it scans Y as input. So as you see, these two are defined in operational terms, but mutual information of X and Y is defined as sum of these three terms. So it's C of X plus C of Y minus C of X given Y, which necessitates only the definition of Kolmogorov complexity. And mutual information conditioned on some other string. So here you have mutual information of X and Y given W is defined this way, just like the previous line, but we've added given W, conditional W on each term. There is an operational interpretation of mutual information of X and Y, which is given by this theorem I've just mentioned. It is the optimal size of the secret key that can be established by Alice and Bob when they have keys x and y respectively. And we can also represent Kolmogorov complexity using Venn diagrams. So for the string x, I draw this circle. For the string y, I draw this circle. And then these three parts represent C of x given y, mutual information of x and y, and C of y given x. And C of x is indeed sum of C of x given y plus mutual information of x and y up to some logarithmic additive term. So it might look easy when you see this diagram, because we are used to this kind of thinking by cardinalities of sets, but it's not trivial and the proof is not straightforward. This is called Kolmogorov-Levin theorem, which enables us to draw these diagrams. And the same theorem also enables us to give an alternate definition of mutual information of x and y. I have given here a symmetric definition, but I could have also defined it as C of x minus C of x given y. You can see this on the diagram. Mutual information of x and y is C of x minus C of x given y. Alright, now I can give the more formal introduction. So we have four rules of the game. First rule is that the complexities are publicly known. So the complexity profile of x and y are publicly known. You can deduce C of x from these two and C of y from these two. Alice, Bob, and the eavesdropper, they all know these numbers. Then, x is known only to Alice and y is known only to Bob. I've already mentioned this one. And Alice and Bob want to establish a secret key communicating via a public channel. So the channel is public, eavesdropper has access to all these messages, all this communication transcript, and we want the key to be secret to the eavesdropper. What do I mean by the secret? I haven't explained this one. Let me give the definition of secret. So in theory of Kolmogorov complexity, secret means incompressible. And incompressible means its complexity is almost as much as its length already. So it cannot be compressed to something much smaller than its length. This means that it looks random. And in formal terms, the condition I want on the secret key is that complexity of the secret key given all the public messages is almost as much as the length of the key. So now, given these rules, the theorem by Romachenko and Zeman from their 2019 paper is more clear, I guess. The optimal size of the secret key is mutual information of x and y up to logarithmic additive term, as defined in the previous slide. And the protocol needs to satisfy these rules of the game. Okay, now let me give you an example to explain better how it works. But the protocol that is given by Romachenko and Zeman was working for general x and y. Here I will give a simple example, so I will restrict myself to not general x and y, but to x and y for which the first halves are the same. So this is a restriction to a smaller class of pairs x, y. Just for the simplicity, let's not think about other x and y. And we suppose that it is known by Alice, Bob, and eavesdropper that we are in this class. So then Alice can just take the first half of her string and Bob can just take the first half of his string. So in this class, in this setting, they can establish a secret key without any communication, with zero communication. Of course, this doesn't mean that for any complexity profile, the communication complexity needs to be the same. It doesn't mean there is such a need. And there is no such need, of course. You can have some class XY for which you have the same complexity profile as some other class XY, but for the first class you have this kind of situation in which communication complexity is zero, and for some other class you have communication complexity very high. Now let me give an example for which communication complexity is higher, and which is a non-trivial example compared to the previous one. So let's first take a power of 2 to the n, and then we take a finite field of 2 to the n elements, f2 to the n. Now let's define an affine plane over this finite field. So we take an affine plane in which each point has two parameters, two coordinates, and each coordinate is in f2 to the n. Now on this plane we take a line and a point x and a line y, such that x is on y, or in other words, y goes through x. And we give x to Alice, y to Bob. So in this setting, size of the secret key is, as given by the theorem, is mutual information of x and y, which is n, as given by the theorem I mentioned here from 2019 paper. And mutual information of x and y is n, because x and y can be described in three parameters from this finite field. So just three elements of this finite field will be sufficient to describe x and y. For example, take two coordinates of x and the slope of y. And communication complexity for establishing a secret key where initial keys of Alice and Bob are in this class, so are in points and lines and that are going through each other in the FM plane, is C of x given y, which is n. So it's clear that C of x given y is n from the previous argument. But you can ask why the communication complexity is C of x given y. We have seen from the proof of this theorem I mentioned in this page that they have given a protocol, Romachenko and Zimand, that determines a secret key of this size by using communication of C of x given y bits. So we know that the communication complexity cannot be more than C of x given y, because their protocol is for a general case where x and y can be all strings of size n. So here, since we restricted x and y to be this kind of strings where they represent points and lines going through each other, the general protocol can also be used here to have communication complexity n. But how do we know that this cannot be done with less bits of communication? How do we know that communication complexity is not less than this? So it's not trivial, it's not straightforward. The proof is in the paper. You can look at the proceedings or you can look at the full paper on archive. So if you haven't been able to follow the previous slides, I suggest you concentrate on this one, not only because this is the shortest slide of this presentation, but also this is where I will highlight the main work of our article. So the positive result was the upper bound given by Romachenko and Zimand in 2019 paper. That is a protocol that is for all xy can establish the optimal size secret key by using only C of x given y bits of communication. This is a general protocol that works for all xy of size n. So there is no restriction, it's the universal class of initial keys of size n. And negative result, the lower bound of our work, is that for some xy, communication complexity is more than C of x given y. For some xy, I mean, in this example, we have restricted xy to the lines and points of this affine plane. But if even in this situation, the communication complexity is at least n, it means that the communication complexity is a general case where x and y are this particular x and y from this example. The communication complexity of a general protocol should also be at least this much. Of course, I put these inequalities with approximate signs, because here there are some logarithmic additive terms. So here it's in fact C of x given y plus C log n with some small c constant. And here it's C of x given y minus C log n with some small c constant. But these two together, they show that any general protocol that will establish a secret key for x and y of size n, they need to be of communication complexity, worst case communication complexity, C of x given y plus all again, because these lower bound and upper bound are the same up to log n additive term. So you can ask, these two were about establishing a key of size ixy, mutual information of x and y. What if we want to establish a smaller secret key? Do we still need as much communication complexity? Can we use less communication bits and establish a smaller secret key? The question is, it depends. We can restrict ourselves to some classes of XY instead of the universal class of all XY of size n, in which we will have this kind of behavior. You see the phase transition for some other classes of XY, we don't have this phenomenon as we increase gradually the communication complexity that is allowed, communication bits that are allowed. We also increase the size of secret key. So let me give some more details about these two cases. You remember the example of lines and points from discrete plane, from affine plane. So if I restrict myself to the class of lines and points instead of all strings of size n, then I have this kind of graph. So for communication complexity more than c of x given y plus c log n for some c, that is, if I permit myself to use, I permit Alice and Bob to use at least as many bits as c of x, y, c of x given y plus c log n, then they can establish the optimal size secret key. Of course, this won't go up because this is the optimal size secret key for x, y. But if I don't let them use any more communication bits than c of x given y minus c log n, then the key that they can establish is of size O log n at most. It cannot be more than O log n. So that is a secret key of negligible size. It's not meaningful. And as you see, this phase transition happens in this neighborhood of C of x given y of O log n size. Now for some other classes of xy, there is no such phase transition phenomenon. An example of such a class is, take pairs xy such that the Hamming distance between x and y will be fixed. Like, if you say n for the size of x, length of x and length of y, take some theta between 0 and 1 and fix theta times n to be the Hamming distance between x and y. So for this class, as we increase the communication complexity gradually from 0 to c of x given y, the size of the secret key that we can establish also increases. But we don't know how exactly this function behaves between 0 and c of x given y. That's why this is a dashed function here. But we know how some lower bounds and upper bounds are satisfying the inequalities for this function. So this function needs to be higher than this lower bound that is linear, and lower than this upper bound that is linear. And for the details of this lower and upper bounds, you can look at the paper. Now that I have finished talking about the statements of our article, I can talk about the proofs. Of course, I won't have time to make a proof here, but I will talk about the combinatorial techniques that were used in the proof. So first of all, I will talk about a useful lemma. While I'm explaining this lemma, you can forget about this secret key agreement protocols and the problem that we are interested in, and concentrate only on this graph theoretical lemma. So given a bipartite graph, if left and right hand side of this graph have as many elements as each other, the cardinalities are the same, so there are as many nodes here, as many vertices here as here. If this is a bipartite graph that is regular of degree d, that is, each node, each vertex has d neighbors, and if the second eigenvalue is called lambda 2, so the first eigenvalue is of course d, because this is a regular bipartite graph of degree d, and if we call second eigenvalue lambda 2, then for any subset A of left side and any subset B of right side, we will have this inequality. And this inequality, where E of AB means the number of edges between A and B, this inequality can be interpreted as a restriction, a bound, an upper bound, on how much the edge density between A and B can deviate from edge density between left and right hand sides of this bipartite graph. So smaller lambda 2 is, and larger cardinality of A times cardinality of B is less can be the deviation of edge density between A and B from edge density between left and right hand side of this graph. Now, how do we use this lemma that is about graph theory? We first take a corollary of this lemma by taking the good values for lambda 2 and A times B. We can make the right hand side small compared to the second term in the left hand side in the absolute value. And when we have this, the lemma translates as an upper bound on number of edges between A and B. And this edge density or this number of edges that is being small can be translated in Kolmogorov complexity, thus information theory language, and it will give us a conditional information inequality. So here I will give an example for this special class of pairs XY, which are lines and points on the discrete plane defined on finite field we have defined in previous slides, a few slides ago. So in this case, the lemma translates as this. For all string W, we have C of X given W plus C of Y given W larger than 3n implies this information quantity larger than n plus all again. And in fact, the same lemma, same conditional inequality is valid for other pairs XY when the spectral gap is large. So as long as lambda 2 is large, this will work for other classes, not only this class. I'm giving the example here, other classes satisfying the spectral property. Now you can ask, what is the spectral gap for these pairs? Because we have defined spectral gap from the adjacency matrices of bipartite graphs. So the answer is, we define bipartite graphs for pairs XY or classes XY by using other X similar to the original X here. So here we take strings that are similar to X, and here we take strings similar to Y, including X on the left side and Y on the right side. And then we connect some X primes and Y primes if they look similar to XY. If pair X prime Y1 prime looks similar to the pair original pair XY, then we connect them. So you can ask what similar is. It is behaving in similar complexity profile in terms of Kolmogorov complexity. For more details, you can look at the paper. But this property is true for all classes for which, all classes of XY for which we have the spectral gap property. We have large spectral gap. That is, we have small second eigenvalue. And we can also extend this lemma to the pairs XRA, YRB, where RA and RB are random bit strings. And this means that our result that is following from this lemma is also valid for the case with private randomness. So, as conclusion, we have proven a lower bound matching the upper bound for the communication complexity of the problem of secret key agreement with private randomness. And in fact, our argument that is extended to random bits here, it works only when the size of these random strings is polynomial in size of X and size of Y. So if n is length of X and length of Y, then RA and RB needs to be in polynomial size of n for our argument to work. And a wide open question is the tight trade-off between the communication complexity and the size of the secret key for XY without large spectral gap. So I said that when we have large spectral gap, then we have a general characterization of pairs XY, and we have this lemma. But when we don't have large spectral gap, for example, in this Hamming distance, fixed Hamming distance pairs, this class I have given, we don't have large spectral gap. Second eigenvalue here is big. That's why we have made a case study of Hamming distance, a fixed Hamming distance example. But we don't have a general characterization of pairs with large spectral gap. Thank you for your attention.